Hi, everybody, and welcome to Hot Mama Summer Workshop. Thanks for coming. We have some of you who are joining us live or watching a recording of this. So thanks for coming to our workshop. Just to let you know, we're going to talk about things like incontinence when you have drips and dribbles. We're going to talk about pelvic pain. Talk about tailbone pain, the pooch, and some other things that happen to us who, namely those of us who are women, but it can happen to many people, men and women. And tell you the definitions of things, tell you why these things happened, and then some things you can do to help yourself so that you can start to correct them and get some treatment. So let's get right into it. The first thing I want to talk about is drips and dribbles or incontinence. Incontinence is the involuntary leakage of urine. There are several types of incontinence. One of those is stress incontinence. So people will often say that they leak urine when they cough or sneeze, or maybe they hit a tennis ball or pull a door open. And that's a strength issue. There's a higher pressure that goes, that occurs across our bladder, and we don't have the pelvic floor strength to be able to control that. So that is called stress incontinence, and that's the most common thing that happens, especially during pregnancy. Urge incontinence is when a person would say they have increased frequency, increased urgency, and that's a bladder issue. There's a muscle inside the bladder that can cause this to happen, and that muscle is called the detrusor. So it's overactivity of that muscle. And then there's mixed incontinence, which is a combination of both of those things. So let's just talk about where some of those things are. So here is a model of the pelvis, the pelvic girdle. This is your pubic ridge. These bones are called your ilium. When I turn it around, we've got our spine here, our sacrum. This is the sacroiliac joint, or SIJ. Many people have SIJ issues, which are like back pain issues. When I turn this downward, you look inside, this sling of muscles I'm holding is your pelvic floor muscles. So they attach to the sacrum. Here's your tailbone embedded in there. And you can look inside and see how all those muscles fit together. From the outside, this is a female pelvis. So we see the opening to the vagina is called the introitus. The vagina is actually the cave inside. The opening is called the introitus. The labia would sit up here, that's the skin. So this looks like we have a lot of space between the introitus and the bone, and there are two muscles in there. We don't really have that much space, but on this model, it sure looks like there's a lot of distance there. But these two muscles can cause some problems, cause tension here at the introitus or in this perineal region. When we look inside again, the round hole is the rectum where the poop comes out. The square hole is the vagina, and the yellow hole is the urethra or the pee tube. The bladder sits just inside this pelvic girdle below the level of the pubic ridge, and as the bladder fills and gets larger, it starts to rise up, just like how when a balloon would fill with air, it's going to expand inside in size. So keep these things in mind. I mentioned the detrusor muscle. So the container called the bladder has a muscle inside of it, and that muscle is called the detrusor. It detects the stretch as the bladder is enlarging. It sends messages then to the brain, and this cycle works together so that our body knows if we are filling, if we're getting close to full, or if we're at our maximum capacity and we need to empty. So stress incontinence is a strength issue, meaning that these pelvic floor muscles are not strong enough to close down around the yellow hole, the urethra, pinching that urethra, like stepping on the garden hose. So they're not strong enough to do that in stress incontinence. We also have a sphincter at that urethra, But the sphincter does get a lot of assistance from our pelvic muscles. When I said urge incontinence is a bladder issue, it's the muscle inside of this bladder called the detrusor. Okay. So just to cover a couple of numbers, the capacity of the bladder is about 8 to 12 ounces. When the bladder empties, we should have less than 1 ounce of urine left in the bladder. There really should not be anything left over. Normal voiding intervals, or times between pees, is 2 to 4 hours. If you drink a ton of water, or a lot of bladder irritants, which we'll talk about in a little while, you're gonna pee more often. But 2 to 4 hours is the normal interval between the need to void, or between times that you go to the bathroom. Voiding volume is usually 8 to 12 ounces. There are some people who have huge bladders. They may pee 22 ounces. That's not typical. And sometimes that can cause problems for people when you hold more than 12 ounces. When you get up to the 20s, then that's a pretty large capacity. Sometimes that can cause issues. So why do we get drips and dribbles? Why do we get incontinence? Often it's habit. Sometimes we have an overly full bladder. Bladder can't contain that 22 ounce volume of urine, and it just doesn't have the strength to be able to hold on to that. So constantly holding your urine in and having an overly large bladder is going to cause tremendous amount of work. You have to have superhuman strength in those pelvic floor muscles, or you're probably going to have some leakage when the pressure becomes too great and you cough and you sneeze. You'll probably have some leakage. So I say habit because nobody's going to have that kind of superhuman strength to hold it. It still is a strength issue, but it can be changed by changing your habits. We've already mentioned that there's a strength issue. That can be one of the reasons for incontinence. And then detrusor overactivity. Sometimes the muscle inside this bladder is just overactive and it's constantly trying to fire. So that's more of a neurological type thing. And we'll just leave it at that one. Overactivity of that muscle. Sometimes people have frequency, which we talked about in urge incontinence. Frequency can be caused by habit. If you are somebody who says, I'm getting ready to go up the road, I better go pee before I leave, that's a habit. You may not have had to pee. So you're training your bladder not to contain its full contents. If you were supposed to hold 8 to 12 ounces and you get ready to go out the door and maybe you only have 1 or 2 ounces in your bladder and you decide to sit on the potty, and now your bladder says, gosh, when I get to 2 ounces or 4 ounces, I better get the signal to the brain that I'm supposed to empty. So if repeatedly you're always emptying your bladder just in case is JIP, just in case, so we call them JIPs. If you're always doing a JIP, your habit is causing your urgency. So try not to go until you really feel that urge come on, and then you'll be better off. Every now and then to do a JIP is fine, but on a regular basis, that habit's going to cause urgency. Incomplete emptying is another habit. Teachers, nurses, moms who don't have time to go sit on the potty will go up there, they hover over the potty sometimes, they don't really sit down and take a long time to pee, and they get just enough out to make the urge go away if they didn't fully empty. Remember, I said we should have less than an ounce left in our bladder, but if you didn't fully empty, your bladder still detects that stretch, and your bladder keeps filling throughout the day. So your bladder is going to tell you often that you have to pee if you don't completely empty. So the best way to pee is to sit on the potty, get yourself in a relaxed position, relax your pelvic floor, and take the time to allow this process to happen. So let's talk about that a little bit. This diagram is going to show you really what happens inside. This is your bladder. These are your pelvic floor muscles. When your pelvic floor muscles are active, your bladder cannot be active. They work inversely to each other. So if your bladder is contracting to try to empty the contents, your pelvic floor muscles should be relaxed. If, on the other hand, you hear the phone ring, and you contract your pelvic floor and go, oh, what's that? You have just contracted pelvic floor, causing them to be active, and you shut off your detrusor or your bladder muscle. So we want to make sure that pelvic floor muscles are relaxed when we're peeing and that they're active when we're snoring. So I have other ways or more ways that you can fix this. And one of them is the bladder diary, which I didn't bring here, but I can give that to you guys as a handout. I'll send that to you. A bladder diary is a way of recording what comes in and what goes out. So everything that you drink throughout the day is recorded on the log, starting at the time you wake up, and every half an hour you would make an entry if needed of things that you're drinking. Every time you pee, you're going to take a 2-cup measuring cup or more if you have a large capacity bladder. Pee into the cup, note how much volume you've peed out, pour that out, note that on your sheet at the appropriate time. For people who drink a coffee in the morning and then maybe they have a big thing of water in the meantime and then they have more coffee, you just draw a line down where you had started that water. Let's say you took 3 hours to drink a big goblet of water, you would simply note on there that you started at one time, you ended at another, and in the meantime, you drank coffee, you drank iced tea, you drank orange juice, something like that. So all of the volume of fluid is denoted on there that you've taken in and everything that you've gone out that has gone out. And a physical therapist would take a look at that and see how much is coming in, how much is going out, what are the intervals in between. What is the volume that is happening when you're peeing? And then make correlations on there to be able to see where some problems are lying. And that is one way that a person could start to look at their bladder habits and make some changes. Many people are drinking bladder irritants, iced tea, sodas, juices, all these things that have acidic qualities to them are irritants to the bladder. They say milk is also an irritant. I'm not quite sure about that, but that's on the list. Think about when you drink iced tea or coffee and you have to pee pretty quickly after that. You really just can't hold that. So that's a bladder irritant too. I have a document that I will send to everybody that gives you an idea of how to look at your bladder diary and some interpretations on that. So that's in your handouts. So one of the things that you can fix after you've done your bladder diary is seeing what the voiding schedule is. If you're peeing 4 or 5 hours apart, you might need to do a little voiding schedule and make yourself empty sooner. Or maybe you need to have more volume coming in. Maybe you're not drinking enough. If you see that you're drinking a lot of volume of bladder irritants, decreasing the amount of irritants is going to help that bladder not to be overactive. Another fix for stress incontinence is to do Kegels and to strengthen. We have this guide on how to do Kegel strengthening, and I can send a link to anybody who's listening online as to where you find that link and how you do your Kegels. It's at the Ultimate Guide for Kegels at serendipptseminars.teachable.com, but we'll put that link and send that out afterwards. In general, Kegels are going to be when you contract the muscles of your pelvic floor, these guys in here, and you hold for 5 seconds, you rest for 10 seconds. So that was 15 seconds, that interval. In 1 minute, you can get 4 of them done. In 5 minutes, you can get 20 of them done. I'd like to have people divide them up to 3 times a day. So you may do 20 in the morning, 20 in the day, 20 in the evening. So you're not working at times when your muscles are very weak. If I made you do all 60 at one time, I bet you number 40 through 60 is not going to be as good as number 1 through 20. So I like to have people break them up. You would progress your Kegels up to doing 10 second holds and 10 second release. relaxations again for 3 times per day. Another advance to that would be trying to hold your muscle and then pulse it. So think about, I'm just gonna do this with my arm. If I had my arm here and I contract, and I contract again, pulsing would be this kind of thing. And sometimes you'll see in a bar class, you lift your leg up and down, you might pulse at the top. So if we think about our kegels sitting down here, when we contract the kegels, they lift and they lower, and they relax, they lift and they lower. So for a kegel, you would hold your kegel for about 2 seconds, then you can pulse, pulse, pulse at the top before letting it drop. That takes motor control, it takes strength, but it's an advancement of your progress. So how do you do a kegel? You're going to pull your muscles in as if you're holding back gas from your urine. It's a contraction of these muscles of your pelvic floor. It would be like holding back the gas, pulling in the rectum, but trying to advance that all the way to the front where the pubis is. One way to get a co-contraction and to make sure that you're actually doing it is to pull the belly in, like suck in the gut, but I don't mean to hold your breath. So pull your belly in, like you wanna make, you wanna zip up the pants and you have to make your belly come inward. So that muscle is called your transverse abdominis. When you contract your transverse abdominis or TVA, it causes a co-contraction of your pelvic floor. So that's a way to get a start on how to do your pelvic floor muscle contractions. Another way to check if you're doing it properly would be look at yourself in the mirror, spread your legs apart, put the mirror there, see if you're lifting the muscles or relaxing them. Watch yourself go up and down at your pelvic floor. If you're sitting on a hard chair and you do a kegel, sometimes you can feel your perineum lift up off of that chair. You could squeeze your finger or your partner's finger and see if the muscles get tight around that finger. There's another way that people talk about that I just want to speak to quickly. People sometimes say stop the stream of urine to check and see if you're doing a pelvic floor contraction. You can do that one time a month, but if you do that on a regular basis, that's one of those habits that's going to cause you problems. So if you contract your pelvic floor muscles to check, and you do that as a way to strengthen, which is what a lot of nurses and doctors tell their patients, then ultimately, you're not going to have full emptying of your bladder. Remember when we went back to here, we said you contract your pelvic floor muscles, your detrusor muscle shuts off. So if you constantly are contracting your pelvic floor muscles during urination, you're retraining your bladder not to fully empty. And there's a great article that talks about the Kegel Symphony. So think about if you're listening to this beautiful orchestra and the strings are playing and everything's going along really, really well. Everything's flowing. And the next thing you know, somebody walks out with this electric guitar and starts messing up the symphony. It's going to take some time for that symphony to reorganize and get itself started again and coordinate how to get back on that piece of music that they were playing. That same thing happens when you constantly are interrupting the pee cycle by contracting pelvic floors. So that's not a great way to strengthen the pelvic floor. It is fine once a month to be able to try to do that to see if you can contract the pelvic floor. Good? Okay, so the next thing is pelvic pain. So pelvic pain is considered pain anywhere in your body from your pubic bone back to your tailbone and sacrum, between your ilium or your hip bones, and everything in between, and all the way down to your sit bones down here. So that's pelvic pain. Often it's because the muscles inside are in spasm. Sometimes the organs could be causing you some discomfort. For what we're talking about today, it's usually an overactivity of the tension of your muscles. These muscles that I didn't talk about right in here, that are cut off, are hip rotators. So this muscle would attach to where my wrist is here and cause your leg bone to go outward this way. These guys can become problematic from falls, sometimes from sports, and they're part of the sling that's helping to support the pelvic floor. That's called your obturator internus, your hip external rotators, and they can be real buggers and cause a lot of pelvic and hip pain. So sometimes surgery can cause your muscles to tense up. If you've had a back surgery, a hip surgery, abdominal surgery, even something to the organs, the muscles inside will tense up in response, and then that clenching can cause you the pain. Another thing, another reason for this pelvic pain could be a malalignment of your sacroiliac joints or your pubic ridge or even your spine that's here. And then the muscles inside will start to react and need to be released. So ways to fix that. One could be physical therapy to help mobilize these joints. I do have on my Teachable website that we spoke of before, I've got videos on how to mobilize your pelvis and how to assess if your pelvis is rotated or upslit. Some little self-help techniques are in that website for that video. Another way is to take a ball and do a ball smash. I think some people have used this before, where if you've got glute pain, glute muscles would be here, you would lie upon that and allow yourself to sink over the ball, pretending you're the cheese and it's the hamburger and you're melting over that ball. You could put that into your low back muscles. You could roll over and go into your hip flexor, psoas muscles as well. There's another device called the TheraWand, which I don't have here today, but it's an S-shaped lucite wand that you can insert yourself through the vagina, and it gives you a way to be able to reach those muscles inside and to treat your pelvic floor muscles. So this wand would come in through the introitus and be able to touch the various muscles of your pelvic floor. I have a video as well that shows you how to do that. But the TheraWand is a great way to do some self-releases and relax those muscles. One other thing that is great, if you have a joint dysfunction here where you're rotated, or you're maybe even sometimes people have delivered a baby and the baby was so large that the ligaments became lax and you don't have a lot of strength in the ligaments of your pelvis, those are the people who have difficulty walking after they've delivered the baby, or they just feel like everything is weak through this region. There's a device called a Sorolla belt. So this would fit around the pelvis. And of course, with all the musculature on there, it's a bit better. But it would wrap around and stabilize your pelvis so that you get like a girdle through there that keeps all of those joints lined up nicely together. I wore the Sorolla belt when I had my twins and I was pregnant with them. Rick Sorolla walked up to me and put this belt on me, and I gotta tell you, this was like a breath of fresh air to put this thing on. So Sorolla belt can be a really nice way to have some balance and stability in your pelvis. So let's move on to painful intercourse, which is also called dyspareunia. So that's anything that happens when you have pain internally here during penetration, either during the internal penetration or just at the entrance. And there's several different causes for that. So often when we have pain at the entrance, at the introitus, it could be a lubrication issue. I advise people to use something called slippery stuff or another lubricant that doesn't have glycerin, because glycerin can be irritating to these tendons. It could also be due to vaginal atrophy as our hormones diminish and we don't have the lubrication through here. The other reason, the other thing that happens as our hormones diminish is that this tissue becomes very frail and stiff. And I think of the area from 4 o'clock to 8 o'clock, that becomes really frail and painful. So doing some releases in that region, releases through the TheraWand or in therapy to get that released. When you have pain deep inside, it's usually because the muscles, the pelvic floor muscles or these obturator internal muscles are in spasm. So being able to release those muscles is going to help stop that pelvic pain. Intercourse should not be painful. It should never be painful. And I've heard a lot of young people who have said to me that they didn't realize that it's not supposed to be painful. It should never be painful. And if it is, typically you should have that treated. So one thing you can do is try and change the position. Sometimes I advise my ladies to be the person on top when you're having intercourse, because then you're in charge. And sometimes that tension can relax because you know that you are able to control that situation and not be afraid that you're going to be hurt. So the mental game is a lot of that too. Pelvic floor muscle treatment is another way that we can address that pain. And then there's another thing that I often tell people about called sensing focus. Are you familiar with that? No. So it's a 4-stage process, and as I'm working on clients, I'll tell them, one, avoid intercourse entirely. So it's all innocent, kind of from the neck up, just kissing, fondling, holding hands, you know, kind of old-fashioned when you're first getting to know each other, being able to be sensual but not being sexual, or showing attention to each other, I should say. And then the second phase would be from the chest up, being able to have some touching of those regions, but trying to avoid intercourse or orgasm. Orgasm is going to cause a contraction of the pelvic floor muscles, which are the ones we're trying to fix. So staying away from having these muscles being contracted and going into spasm is part of sensing focus. Phase three would be oral penetration and manual penetration. So everything like third base, if you want to call it that. And then stage four would be having penetrative intercourse where the female is on top and again, you know, control the situation. During that whole stage of sensing focus, which could be 4 to 6 weeks, the person should be getting treated for pelvic floor physical therapy or doing some pelvic floor therapy themselves. The next topic we're going into is nocturia. So that means nighttime urination. So the urge to get up and pee at night, which is unwanted. So many new moms have the issue of nocturia, but they don't know, was it that I woke up because of my child and I just peed anyway? Or was it that I woke up to pee and I checked on my child? So if you simply woke up and it was because of your child and you peed, that's not an issue. But when you didn't want that urge and it woke you and it made you arise to get up at night, that's called nocturia. That's usually an overactive bladder. There are some other issues that go into the actual overactivity of the detrusor muscle that we can't treat ourselves for that. But one quick fix, if it's a habit, is to stop drinking 2 hours before you go to bed. So taking a water bottle to bed and sipping on that the whole night is not going to help nocturia. But stopping your beverages 2 hours before you go to bed, and especially stopping bladder irritants earlier in the evening, will help you to be able to stay in bed longer. This is a time when I'd have someone look back at their bladder diary and let's see what's going on throughout the day that might give us some ideas of what's happening overnight. But that quick fix of stopping your beverage intake and those bladder irritants closer to bedtime is really going to help with that one. Pelvic organ prolapse. So inside of our bladder, inside our pelvis, we have our bladder, we have our rectum, and we have our uterus. And sometimes those organs can descend and they start to appear through the vagina. They might appear right at the entrance, they might descend through it, they might actually fall the whole way through. That's the pelvic organ prolapse. The symptoms of that are a heaviness or a pressure in this region. There can also be inability to completely empty or completely defecate, empty out your bowels, because that organ is sitting there acting as an outlet obstruction to either the urethra or the bowels. So those organs need to be raised back up, if you will.
Is that something you can prevent, or is that?
Yes. Yeah, so that goes back to our strengthening. So let's think about this. So we're going to use the example, since we're on the shore, of we've got a dock, and I know this is not how we dock boats, but I'm just going to use this example. So we've got a dock, and we've got a boat. A boat is tied between these two docks, and you've got your lines out there anchoring that thing in. And everything's fine. It's hanging out there just fine in the water. And then we drain the water, and that boat's going to drop down. So those lines are going to get stretched out as it's trying to support that boat without water under it. The boat is your organs. The lines are your ligaments supporting those organs. And the water underneath are your pelvic floor muscles. So what you have to do is have really strong pelvic floor muscles to be able to act as a buttress to help lift them up. So to answer your question, Diane, yes. Is that something you can prevent? Yeah, you want to start to do your Kegel exercises and create that nice supportive sling underneath of our pelvis. Another reason, though, that pelvic organ prolapse can happen is because there's tension inside. So if I pull on my dress here, you can see that it deforms. You see how my top moves a little bit. Or if I pull on the table, you see how everything starts to go traction down toward it. So this child's toy is a nice example of a tensegrity model. So if I traction through this elastic string, the whole thing becomes deformed. Now, if I let go of the tension, it goes back to where it should have been. There's research that shows that pelvic organ prolapse can happen because there's a downward tension in the pelvic floor or in that pelvic region that is tractioning those organs downward. If we can release that tension through pelvic floor therapy, through the TheraWand, through balancing of the joints, then those organs can resuspend to where they want it to be. Just like if I had put a stitch in my dress and then I release the dress can go back to where it needed to be. So generally pelvic organ prolapse is because of muscle weakness, but it can be because of tension. And the fix is to lengthen those restrictions and to strengthen the pelvic floor muscles. We always want to lengthen before we strengthen. If something is too short, strengthening a short muscle doesn't really work. You can't get it any shorter. So you have to lengthen before you can strengthen. Questions on that? So then tailbone pain. So remember where the tailbone is. It's embedded in your pelvic floor muscles right here. So people can have tailbone pain from birth injuries. The baby came through and was jamming into that tailbone. And it can get twisted, it can get curled, it can get pushed out, it can fracture. So sometimes long labors can cause tailbone pain. Another thing that can happen is you slip on ice, you fall, you land on the tailbone. You fall off the swing, you land on your tailbone. And it's gonna curl in. So think about what happens when the tailbone gets injured. It's the attachment point of the pelvic floor muscles. So if it's curled inward, now those pelvic floor muscles are slackened and they've become, the origin to the insertion has become shorter. So that can change the condition of the pelvic floor muscles. So having an issue to your tailbone causes pelvic floor muscle issues, which can lead to urination issues, pain issues, and of course, all the things we already covered. So having a tailbone issue is something that should be treated. One quick fix on that, again, is the TheraWand that we talked about earlier, being able to go in and adjust the muscles. Another one is to take a wooden dowel, and I didn't grab that, but the roll that the toilet paper spins on, those old-fashioned wooden ones, where you can go to the store and buy a wooden dowel that's about that thick, or a big fat highlighter. And if you sit on that wooden dowel, so it's between your sit bone and the center of the perineum, you're going to sit on that dowel, slump backwards and lean toward the side that the dowel is on. It's like doing a ball smash right into those muscles, right up into your pelvic floor muscles. And this is cut for my model, but it will go right into that obturator internus. So that's a nice way to help to start to release the muscles that are anchoring that tailbone and causing some of that pain. I don't know that tailbone pain actually, or that tailbones actually go back to their proper positioning I do know that the muscles will release and the pain can be relieved, but the actual deformity of the bone, by the time the person feels better, they don't come back just to have their tailbone sit normally, but they feel better. Okay, so the thing I kept for last is the pooch. So the pooch would be that adipose tissue that we women get and men get below the belly, so right under the belly button. Some of the causes of that are genetics. Sometimes people just put on weight in that region. Other causes can be abdominal surgeries, a C-section. That C-section is a huge scar that was put into your tissue to be able to get to the baby, or any kind of abdominal surgery where they had to cut through there. So that has anchored all that tissue down and it's pulling everything toward it. There's no movement in that region. When we have a scar in our body heals that scar by laying down all kinds of collagen and elastin, but it doesn't necessarily lay it down in an organized fashion. So it lays it all down and it gets all haphazard and tight in there. So again, no movement. Normal tissue, your fascial tissue, should have spaces in between. But when this scar tissue lays down, it lays down and there's no space in between. It just wanted to heal the thing. So you can do scar massage in there. You can release the tissue by pressing into it, elongating, friction massage across it, doing some opening diagonally through those scars, and helping to elongate that tissue again, creating space in the fascial tissue. And then the hydration can come back. That scar can start to lay like this again. Doctors will tell you that it takes a year for a scar to remodel, and that's true. And they think that that's all that can happen. In a year, you're done. Nothing else is happening with that scar. That's not true. I have worked on scars, and numerous friends of mine who are myofascial release therapists as well. You can work on scars forever, and they will always remodel and change in their appearance. You can get great relief by doing scar tissue massage. The reason that's important is because if we start to create motion through the scar, some of that adipose tissue doesn't accumulate there anymore. It's not being restricted anymore, and now that appearance can look more smooth there. That makes sense? So one last reason for having that little pooch can be food choice. And there's a whole other series we could do about food choices and foods that are inflaming, and foods that are going to cause your gut to have excess adipose tissue or your gut not to function properly. So having anti-inflammatory foods, decreasing your sugar, your dairy, your wheat, having probiotics added to your diet, prebiotics, all of those can be really great to be able to improve the appearance of our abdomen. Pelvic tilt series is a simple exercise that people can do to help that lower abdominal region. So I mentioned the transverse abdominis muscle before, the TVA, suck in the gut muscle. So if you lay down, and I think a lot of people have done yoga before, you do a pelvic tilt back and forth, which is a rocking of that pelvis. So you do little pelvic tilts. Well, the muscle that enables you to do the pelvic tilt is your rectus abdominis and your transverse abdominis. It's a fabulous exercise and it's super simple to do, but it makes a huge difference if you do it quite a bit of pelvic tilts. So I like to do a pelvic tilt series where I have you do 10 pelvic tilts. Then you would hold your pelvic tilt and your knees are bent. Then you might do a little mini march with the knees up and down. And then go back to doing 10 pelvic tilts. So you've done 30 exercises. Do those every day, and that can really help as a fundamental exercise to strengthen your lower abdomen. And that's a great exercise that's going to build and be the foundational aspect.